Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Download the SDNet app to your mobile device and listen wherever you are. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you.
Welcome all our home listeners and those of you in the audience. Just a reminder, if you're going to speak, please sign in. Always identify yourself before you speak so our home audience knows who you are. Please silence your cell phones. There's a large penalty that goes if they go off, and I don't think you want to find out what it is. So with that, we will start and continue on with our hearing. And we have Pages. All right, Pages, we need to come up to a microphone, that last chair right up here. Or you can go in the middle one, I don't care. Identify who you are, where you're from, where you go to school, and what your future plans, if you have.
Hi, my name is Keegan Baker. I'm a senior from Skyland High School. And after school, I plan to attend the University of South Dakota for accounting.
Hi, my name is Zahira Muhammad. I'm a senior at Sioux Falls Jefferson High School. I plan to attend University of Omaha, Nebraska for political science and international affairs.
Very good. Well, thank you. We appreciate you being here today, and thank you again. Okay. With that, do you have a personal privilege?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. Personal privilege. I would just like all of our listeners to know it's Commissioner Terwilliger's birthday today. Thank you.
Just the right entry for starting the budget for the Bureau of Finance and Management. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, and thank you, Chair Derby, for letting the world know that's listening to the Appropriations Committee today. It's my birthday. It's always a good day when you get to spend some time in the Appropriations Committee and celebrate a birthday, 2 days in a row as well. So absolutely it is. It's a privilege. All right. Without any further ado, I'm going to jump into the budget for the Bureau of Finance and Management, and we'll push through this presentation. As we go through it, if there's any questions, please don't hesitate to jump in. Starting out here, I'm not going to talk too much about myself. We did some introductions yesterday, but I do want to introduce some of members of my team that I did not introduce yesterday. Of course, my name is Jim Terwilliger. I'm the BFM commissioner. Stephen Kohler is our deputy commissioner. You met him yesterday. Rounding out the rest of my leadership team, Morgan Griebley, she is not here with us right now, but she's our chief budget analyst. Colin Keeler, many of you know Colin, I introduced him yesterday. He's our financial systems director. Keith Sanger, Keith, you with us? Keith, he is our financial reporting director, and I'll go through our program areas here in a minute, but Keith's the leader of our financial reporting team. Rachel Williams. Rachel's here with us. Rachel Williams is relatively new within her role here in the last couple months, and she is the Executive Management Finance Office Director. As the finance officer, so she serves as basically the finance officer for all the bureaus, so not only BFM, but also BHR, BIT, and BOA. And so in future years, I'll probably have Rachel get up here and talk a lot about the BFM budget. But you also see Rachel present for the other Bureau's budget presentations as well. Derek Johnson, you met yesterday. He's a state economist. And then lastly, we have Allie Kerr. Allie is our statewide internal control officer. And so she advises the State Board of Internal Control and all the work that she does for that area. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. And so before I go on, my leadership team at BFM, I'm very proud of them. We do a lot of hard work throughout the year. And I just want to thank them for all the work that they do. And welcoming me as into BFM and back into BFM family. Okay, agenda. We'll do is overview of programs. We'll go through our workforce, cover the recommendation for fiscal year 24. And some of the mid-year adjustments, and then we'll talk a little bit about the Bureau outlook. First of all, our mission: ensure the efficient and responsible management of state government and advise the governor on overall fiscal policy. Pretty straightforward. I'm going to talk through some of the programs. We have many of you, yesterday we had a big discussion about the budget. And the budget analysis team that I introduced yesterday is probably the most visible piece of BFM. But actually, it's a kind of a small component of what BFM does. We have really a wide-ranging responsibilities. We have six functional areas. I'm going to go through those. And we also have three authorities that are attached to BFM for reporting purposes, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Okay, first of all, big picture, this is the fiscal year 2024 recommended budget, $250 million. Part of this is it's a little deceiving, if you will, because of that, a really big piece of it, two big pieces of it, if you will, are in those two areas, the employee compensation and billing pool. And so that's the pool where all the funds for salary policy, bureau billings, so all those funds get distributed. Those funds and authority get distributed out to all the agencies after everything is completed and appropriated and the budget is finalized. those funds will get transferred out. So this is a pool for that $137 million, or about 55%. The other big piece of that is the coronavirus stimulus pool, $100 million. We talked a little bit about that yesterday. The goal would be to start winding that down here over the next couple of years and start reducing those federal coronavirus stimulus authority area. And so those are two huge, big components of it. But if you take those out, we're looking at about $9 million in total funds between the six functional areas that I'm going to cover here in the next several slides. First one, budget analysis. This is the area that you're most familiar with. Produce the budget book, summary budget book, assist work with state agencies in a whole host of budget matters, budget transfers, fiscal year end, so on and so forth, long-term financial plans. There's links to all these on these slides, so I'd invite you to go out and check out a lot of the publications that are put together. We have monthly financial metrics that I encourage you all to take a look at, not only measuring our general fund revenues, but a whole host of other measures that reflect the economy and the health of our economy, and so on and so forth. The next area is revenue and economic forecasting. We covered this in pretty in-depth yesterday, so I won't go into really any more detail in that. Derek Johnson, our state economist, is the person that's in charge of that. I should say, go back to the budget analysis team. We have a chief budget analyst and four analysts, and then I consider myself part of that team, so it's a relatively small team. For the revenue and economic forecasting, it's kind of a team of one. Derek does a lot of that work by himself. The next area is the Executive Management Finance Office. I introduced Rachel, and she's the leader of that team. But it's what these folks do, and there's 9 FT included in this area. They prepare Bureau financial statements. They establish the Bureau billing rates, managing the budget for the four bureaus. They also work on a statewide cost allocation plan that we work with every year with the federal government, so that we can allocate our costs out amongst the other agencies and state government, and a whole host of other general accounting functions specific to the four different bureaus in state government. Next one is the financial systems and operations. We talked some about this yesterday, and this is probably related to the ERP, or really more related to the ERP system that we covered, but this team is critical for the financial systems, the accounting systems, payroll systems, and make sure that they're working. A whole host of background work that goes on, issuance of 1099s, W-9s, and all those types of things. There's a team of 9 folks right now, or 9 FTE, that are budgeted in that area today. Next is the accounting analysis and financial reporting. And this is Keith Sanger is the leader of this team. He's the director in this area. There's 13 FTE in this area. This is relatively new in my time in state government where this team has been built. And I would tell you, this team is responsible for our state's audited financial statements. And so every year, we have a lot of different financial statements, but the ACFR is the acronym, the Annual Comprehensive Financial Report. Over the last several years, when I started in state government, it actually took us 9 months to a year to get our financial statements issued. Several years ago, we took on an initiative to build this team with the goal of issuing our financial reports within a 6-month time frame of the end of the fiscal year, which is the industry standard. That's the expectation. This last year, we were successful in doing that. We issued our ACFR on December 30th, 2022. We didn't have a lot of time to spare with that, and that'll lead into some of the budget requests that we have this year. But I am proud to say that we issued our FY22 ACFR, and we did not have a state financial reporting audit this year. The previous 2 years, we did have what we call a statewide audit finding. And so we got rid of that this year. We're happy about that. And so that team this is the 7th year in a row that we've issued our financial statements within 6 months. The next functional area, statewide internal control office. This is Allie Kerr is the individual that works in this area. She really staffs the State Board of Internal Control. That was established in 2016 that really looks at our internal controls across all of state government. Goes in and does a thorough review, has partners that help, contractual partners that help her get that work done. She's completed 13 different agencies, and over the next couple of years we'll go through and establish those internal controls across all the agencies and state government. And with that, those are the six primary programming areas within BFM. And we also have three authorities that are attached to BFM: South Dakota Building Authority, the South Dakota Health and Educational Facilities Authority, and then the Educational Enhancement Funding Corporation. These authorities, not to get into a ton of detail, but the Building Authority is where if we go and issue bonds for a specific project, that lies within the Building Authority, and then there's a lease appropriation related to make those bond payments. And so we as a state, we are prohibited from issuing general obligation debt. So if you go and look into our Constitution, we don't have the ability to issue debt as a state. And so what has happened is these authorities were created to hold that debt, and then there's a lease appropriation. So we have a moral obligation to make sure that those debt payments get made on behalf. And then once that debt is fully paid, then that asset is fully owned by the state of South Dakota. Moving on, there are no questions about our programming areas. I'd move on to the workforce. Workforce, as I'm sure you'll hear with a lot of agencies, have been very challenging. Our budget.
We have a question.
Yep.
Representative Koth.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioner, you may have mentioned it and I missed it. We talk about the timing of completing the financials. This last fiscal year was 6 months. You were able to. Okay, is that an internal goal? Is that important for budgeting? Is it bond rating? Can you just help me understand where that should be? And then the second part of that question is, with the new dollars that we're looking at, potentially the $70 million, would that enhance that?
Madam Chair, good question. Yes, the 6 months is the industry standard, if you will. The vast majority of states, not all, but the vast majority of states get their financial statements done within a six-month time frame. And so that's really the expectation. When I say the expectation from financial markets. And so when we go and issue bonds and the rating agencies, they look closely at that. Hey, is South Dakota getting their business done on time? And with that industry expectation of 6 months, yes, we have been doing that. And that was the whole, when I first started in state government, we were not AAA rated. And we asked a lot of questions of why. And this was one of those pieces of the puzzle that, hey, we haven't been getting our financial statements done in a timely manner. And we've reversed that course. And I'm proud that we've been able to do that for the last 7 years. And so it's looked at not necessarily from a budget standpoint, but from a financial practices standpoint, it's a very important thing to do. Now, in reference to the enterprise resource planning, I think that'll improve a lot of those processes, but I don't know enough about when we go to RFP and all those types of things of how exactly that'll help us improve. I'm certain it will help us improve and make us more efficient when we do our financial statements. I just don't know to the extent or the magnitude it will, because there's a lot we still don't know until we go out to RFP and start documenting all those processes and procedures. Good question. Okay, moving along in the workforce, our budget includes 45 FTE right now today. Five of those are associated with the authorities. So the BFM proper is 40 FTE. Challenges recruiting staff, recruiting and retaining staff. especially with a small team at BFM. And so we're, you know, responsible for many different operations in some sense. We'll get to this towards the end, but I'm working on making sure that we're doing a good job of succession planning, making sure that we're recruiting and retaining really the next generation of dedicated state employees that can help maintain these operations, beyond my time. So that's really a critical area that we're looking at.
Representative Duva. Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioner Twilliger, is the only option to work here in Pierre, or do you have remote options?
Madam Chair, we have had remote options for folks in the past. Right now, today, I think all of our staff is located in Pierre. We have had situations where folks will live in Pierre for a while and then they'll move away, and we'll offer that as flexibility. I anticipate down the road that with technology and everything, we'll have more of that option. But right now, everybody is located in Pierre.
Follow up. So is that, if you have these openings, is that a realistic opportunity within the year, or is it down the road? I mean, I worked remote for almost 20 years, and it was very effective. So my bosses were all in New York, and then I worked for a company out of Israel, and we figured it out. So I'm just curious. And I lived in South Dakota, so just asking.
Madam Chair, yeah, and I've been fully supportive of remote work. The tricky part with us, with some of the training that comes along with it, for example, if you look at our financial reporting team, governmental accounting is a lot different than your traditional accounting that you learn when you go to college. And so when it comes to the training that it takes to really wrap your arms around and learn that, it's kind of a challenge with remote workers, but we're open to that, and I've been fully supportive of the remote work. I think we're going to see more of that. So we don't limit ourselves to just Pierre. We've had up to two or three remote workers. But it's the challenge we've had lately is those remote workers, if they're not in a good cultured environment, they're not here present, we've lost some of those folks over a few months or a few years. Okay. This slide shows the FTE allocation by area, pie chart on the left side. Then you can see your historical FTE utilization and the bar chart on the right side. Close to fully utilizing those FTE. I think last year in 2022, we had about 94% utilization and a 2.7 unutilized this last year. I would note this last fiscal, I think this is fiscal year, out of our salaried employees, we had over 4,000 hours worked by those salary employees up and above a normal 40-hour work week. And if you look at that, that's almost the equivalent of two extra people. And so that kind of goes into some of the FTE requests that we'll get into here in a minute. Okay. And this next chart just shows a high level just with the numbers of the total budget request. Requested increase of three FTE. And we'll go through each of these in a little bit more detail. The state employee compensation plan is $124.6 million, which includes general funds as well as federal and other fund expenditure authority. This is a pool in BFM, and that'll be distributed, like I said, that'll be distributed out to all the agencies following final passage of the budget this spring. So then that gets loaded into the agency's budget. Next, the Bureau of Billings and Captive Insurance. This is about $3.9 million in total funds. Again, this is a pool in BFM that's included in that pool. Most of this is due to increases in the BIT budget for cybersecurity and those types of things, as well as captive insurance increases within the Bureau of Administration. So when you get to those other Bureau budgets and you look at those, If you would disagree and say, hey, we don't think we should spend that much money, that would have effect on some of these rates that get distributed out to other agencies. Consultant services. Okay, we have two specific requests here for consultant services for financial reporting. We have $250,000 requested increase in other fund expenditure authority, and this is directly related to the financial reporting, the ACFR, and is what we've seen this year in the last couple years. As I mentioned, we got our financial reports issued on December 30th, so we didn't really have any time to spare, and we really had to push staff very hard, not only our staff, but your Department of Legislative Audit staff as well. And so what this would do is help supplement on a contractual basis at certain times of the year, and most of the time the crunch time is kind of after the close of the fiscal year in August, September, and October, and there's just a significant amount of work that has to get done in a small amount of time. And to be honest with you, we burned some staff out. We've lost some staff because of that. And I've challenged Keith and my staff, hey, we've got to figure out a model that is sustainable, that we're not pushing people over the brink. And so this, the intention of these funds would be and go and identify, work with an accounting firm to aid in the preparation of those financial statements year in and year out. The second piece of that is the statewide internal control consultant. And so, as I mentioned, Allie is kind of a one-person office. She also has a consultant contract that helps, and they have the ability to bring in different expertise when we look at different internal controls with other agencies. So, for example, if we go into the Department of Social Services, this consultant will help in, come in and provide specific expertise in that area to help her through that. And so this is something that has been, truly hasn't been, I guess, fully funded in the budget. This is an ongoing cost that we're requesting to be placed in the budget for fiscal year 24.
Senator Breitling.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Commissioner. In the private world, typically there's an accounting firm or auditor that does a review of the internal accounting. So as a state, is that an expectation of the state? Do we have an outside accounting firm that does a review to make sure that our numbers add up, there's no discrepancies, et cetera?
In terms of our normal audit as a state? Yeah, and so the situation that occurs, Madam Chair, is that review for us as a state, and so our team, Keith and his team, puts together our financial statements. And then basically we hand that over, and our auditor is the Department of Legislative Audit, and they'll go through and do all the auditing for all the different funds that we put together. And so they're basically our auditor to make sure that we're reporting and tracking everything appropriately.
Thank you question? For that review.
Very good. Okay. The next request, three FTE, two in our financial systems area, $187,000 in other fund expenditure authority. And this really relates to really a couple primary areas. These two additional folks would not only help with the ERP, and this is separate from what we talked about yesterday. Through our feasibility study that we had conducted, is what they recommended is that we should have approximately 16 people supporting our core financial operations, accounting system, payroll, so on and so forth, go down the line. Right now we have approximately 8. And we have a lot of long tenured staff. And so most of this is really to build this team up for succession planning down the road, and to continue to make sure that we get our ERP system in place and build that team up so that we can be successful long term. And so I understand it's a big ask, but right now with the team that we have in place, they are excellent. They have unique skill sets to where they have a really good handle on accounting and technological skills. But the fact of the matter is we don't have a lot of backups. And so really this is a succession planning down the road. So one of these is a senior software developer for technical support that'll really refine the interfaces between our HR and our payroll systems and the other financial systems. And then one is a management analyst that'll work on reconciliations, monitoring, a lot of the ERP project work, and agency support when it comes to all those areas. Those are the two on the financial systems team. And then we're also requesting one FTE for budget analyst and $91,000. These are general funds. And really two primary reasons here. I went back actually today and I went and looked, I picked up a 1987 budget book. And in that budget book, there was a budget analysis team, and I think at that time there was 11 FTE. Now, I'm not trying to make an apples-to-apples comparison, but now today our budget analysis team, if you include me and the state economist, we're at about 9. In 1987, our general fund budget was $370 million. Today it's $2.2 billion. I feel like over time, budget analysts, and in my experience, a well-trained budget analyst can find a lot of creative different solutions. They can find different ways to pay for things, different funding recommendations. That overall, I believe that it's a very efficient way, and to make sure that we're getting as much return on investment on as we can for the taxpayers of South Dakota. So I think we can, not that we haven't been doing a good job, but with the vast amount of dollars that we are compared to we were in 1987, and the influx of federal dollars, it doesn't appear that it's going to end anytime soon. We're seeing the COVID ramp down, but the federal dollars are still there, that I think we can do a better job, number one. And number two, when I talked about succession planning, if you'd look around kind of the model for budget analysts in South Dakota, at least for us, has been that if we get somebody in, get them trained up, and they get that experience, a lot of times they end up out in a state agency being a finance officer or CFO for a state agency. And so it's really part of succession planning to make sure from a financial perspective that we're continuing to operate state government in an effective manner. And so those are the basis behind those three FTE, and I'd open to questions if anybody has any.
Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Excuse me. So I believe I heard you say that a recommendation was for 16 staff people to do the work. Who is that recommendation from, or what's the basis of that?
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
Yep, that recommendation was from the consultant that did our feasibility study. I believe it was called ISG. We can provide you a link to that study. I think it's about 100-page feasibility study that goes into all the things about ERP and the amount of staff that should be dedicated to making sure that there's ongoing support for those systems.
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
Thank you. But I think you said you've got this recommendation that we should have 16. We're operating with 8 or 9. Is that correct?
Madam Chair, that's correct. I, to be honest with you, I don't know that 16 is the exact right number. I mean, okay. That's a recommendation.
And that was going to be my next question, if I may. Is it if you get what you're asking for here, you'd then be at 10 or 11 versus 16. Just give me your analysis of that.
Yep. I believe for certain we need to add a couple, and that's why I'm here. The governor agreed, and that's why she included in her budget. I think it's possible over the next several years as we get into our ERP project, if we provided that you agree that we should move forward with that we may need to staff up a little bit more. But I don't know that I'm not confident enough in that I should come and ask for resources for more than that right now. I feel like I can justify this to not only for succession planning, to make sure that we're doing things right. I don't know if 16 at the end of the day is right. I think we'll have to analyze that as we get farther into our project, if that makes sense. Representative Mills.
I have a question. You keep talking succession planning, and then you talk about losing, you mentor up people, and then they move over as to finance officers. I guess I need a clearer explanation when you're saying succession planning. What's your projection for retirements that are coming up in your area?
Give me one second. I have some stats on that, Madam Chair. Today, within BFM, we have, I think we have 37 folks today. We're working on hiring a couple spots, three spots. Today, we have 9.4% of our current staff that are eligible today. In 5 years, just short of 20%, and in 10 years, 25%.
Refresh my memory, how many people have you have left to go to a different agency, say within the last 5 years?
I'd have to follow up on that. I know within the last year for sure, we've lost somewhere along the lines of three budget analysts, a couple accounting analysts. I mean, our turnover rate has been in fiscal year 22 was 30%, which is, you know, when you have a small staff, you lose a few people, that number gets pretty big. Obviously, that's higher than what we'd like it. We want to try and get that down as much as we can. But our turnover rate in 2022 was 30%.
Just one last question. Do those people go to different agencies?
Madam Chair, some of both.
Okay.
We lost some to the private sector, and some we've been able to keep within the state government family as well.
Thank you.
Okay, moving along, next item here is computer system maintenance, $83,000 in other funds. That is pretty simply just inflationary costs, costs of doing business on current services. I think that's a 5% increase on some of the various services that we have now today. Moving on to...
Just a minute, I have a follow-up on that. What were your maintenance costs? What did you ask for last year for? Do you recall?
In terms of an increase?
Right, computer maintenance. So, you know, your maintenance is a little different than when we do with higher ed and buildings and that. So what did you figure in?
Sure. Last year? I'd have to go back. I don't have that right in front of me. But we can follow up on that. I don't know that this is something that we request every year, but as you have contracts, as you well know, it's anywhere from 3 to 5% typically that goes up every year, depending on inflation. Some of them are tied to inflation. It just depends on how those contracts and agreements get set up. But that's what that's initially for. Okay. Next, fiscal year 23 adjustments, $2.8 million in total funds. This is an adjustment for this year, the current year. Again, this is in a pool within BFM. This will be distributed out to agencies following the passage of your amendment to the current year bill, if you agree. These are primarily increases within BIT for cybersecurity and some of those different costs that BIT will discuss when they get up here. Kind of getting down towards the end. Talked about this some yesterday, the ERP project, $70 million in general funds and 45 FTE. Unless there's any questions, we'll have a specific bill hearing on this, and we'll go into much more detail, but I think we covered a lot of that yesterday. If there are any questions, I can certainly take them.
Just a question. The 45 are in addition to the 3 you're asking for. This is completely separate.
It's completely separate because the 45 FTE are contained in the what I'll call the special appropriation for the ramp up and ramp down of the team that has to be on this project for basically a 2 to 4 year period.
So, you know, the question is, how'd you come up with the 70 million and the 45?
The 70 million and the 45 are based off of the recommendations from our feasibility study. So our feasibility study came up with a certain dollar amount.
Okay.
It was a little bit less. We had made an inflationary adjustment that matches up with the 70 million, and then the 45 FTE are also from The feasibility study that came from our consultant that, you know, we can talk a lot more about that when we get to the bill hearing as well, that whole process that we've gone through. Okay, Bureau Outlook. Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So when we were having this conversation about the ERP, it was the first time I think I'd heard that we would ramp up with 45 FTEs to handle this. And there was a question follow-up, would those FTEs dissolve or go away later? And I think that was the first time I heard, well, there's a recommendation we have 16. That was the first time I kind of heard that number. So I'm trying to put all these numbers together. Sure. If we add the other three FTEs that are being requested to get us to 10 or 11 that manage the system, in that case, would all of these 45 FTEs here dissolve or not?
Madam Chair, the intention would be that these 45 FTE are all temporary in nature. Oh. So as it ramps up, we have to have a team that comes in, ramps up, gets that work done. We'll have to get folks out from the agency. But the trick is the agency has to have some folks to come in and backfill and do those, continue to get the work done while we bring the brightest and best into this team. But they're temporary in nature. These 45 FTE are not built into the base budget at all.
Thank you.
Senator Breitling.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioner, can you remind us again, the ERP system, what are the services that are included? So, you know, we've talked a little bit about general ledger, accounts payable, supply chain, payroll, accounts receivable. Are there areas that I'm missing?
Madam Chair, it's mostly going to be what I'll describe as the core financial systems that operate state government. So it's going to be accounting system. That's going to be likely procurement, budget system. Colin, is Colin back here? I'm going to ask Colin to jump up and help briefly talk through that a little bit because he's the most well-versed in this area.
Madam Chair, hi, Colin Keeler, Bureau of Finance and Management. I didn't catch who asked the question. Senator Breitling. Yeah, you hit on a bunch of the main ones. I think ones that also weren't mentioned, modules that we'll be looking at would be fixed assets, inventory, the payroll HR system will be upgraded. You'll have general ledger, budget, the procurement, an accounts receivable system. We don't even have an accounts receivable system today. Accounts payable. So all of those core financial systems that generally comprise an ERP, they're all pretty standard. Every software vendor provides the same options. And we'll evaluate, if you remember yesterday, Jim talked about how we may have to scope down a little bit and not have every bell and whistle. But part of the process with the RFP will be to set that scope, what's all included.
Comment. So again, I think yesterday the statement was made that there's like 100 other software programs out there. So we're talking about the motor vehicle registration, you know, the Medicaid registration and billing process, and then the state employed health insurance and all that. And then, of course, all the other ones as well. So it provides a major overview, but it certainly isn't everything in the state.
Madam Chair. Yeah, Senator, a lot of those systems that were mentioned yesterday are other agency-specific systems that if they deal with dollars, they probably interface with our ERP system today. But they're not part of an ERP system. They feed data in and they pull data out, but they're a separate standalone system.
So, thank you. So, does this engage or is BIT have any involvement with this?
Madam Chair, yes. BIT is one of the driving factors behind why we need to replace our ERP system. They are the ones who support the mainframe environment that it runs on today. They have many systems that are outdated, that are, you know, you've heard them use the word brittle in nature, that need to be replaced. So they're having the same problems that we're having with the staff that they can hire to manage and support that mainframe platform, just like we have trouble getting staff who can manage and support the software that, that agencies use. It's just an outdated technology, and it's going to have to be replaced at some point. And so BIT's involved in this, but they don't they're certainly involved in the procurement process from an IT standpoint as well. And right now they have staff that support our system kind of on the back end, and we're worried about that being able to continue too.
Then just one last question to connect these dots all together. We funded Brittle, what, about $60 million?
I believe it was $10 million, Madam Chair.
Just
initially.
10, okay. Yes. So was this the beginning, or is that separate just for BIT alone and did not involve
in the two, Madam Chair, in the 2021 session, you created the IT Modernization Fund and put $10 million in it. And at that time, $2 million of those dollars were to do a feasibility study for replacing our ERP system, and the other $8 million was for a lot of other small, brittle systems that were being absorbed into the governor's digital citizens portal. So $8 million that BIT is using for other projects, $2 million was set aside for the ERP feasibility study. We spent $606,000 on that feasibility study. And the brittle list continues on in BIT's world, and they'll address that during their budget hearing, I think probably extensively. Then last year, you appropriated another $4.138 million into the brittle, or I'm sorry, into the IT Modernization Fund. And that 4.1 is to do the HR upgrades, or what we call the HCM, Human Capital Management Optimization. We have to upgrade our payroll system. And $1 million of that was for the continuation of the ERP planning, and that's what we're doing right now, is we're working on, you know, the draft RFP. We're working on issuing what's called an RFI, or a request for information. We're working on gaining knowledge about how different vendors may come to us with proposals, and hopefully if you folks agree with us and pass Senate Bill 23, we'll begin to execute on that.
Representative Coles.
A question regarding, I call it the long game. Thank you, Madam Chair. The metrics, a lot of information, and I agree totally that the financial side of our state is of utmost importance for a lot of reasons. And I understand, I think we all do, that technology becomes very antiquated, and it, you have to make that change. I understand it's very expensive, okay? But the metric, you know, we throw a lot of numbers out, FTEs, this is what it's going to do, whatever. The other thing that I get concerned about is when the likes of me will set up metrics out there and say, well, this is what we heard, this is what we expect. Is there, and help me understand other committee members, is there thoughts on what do we expect it to look like or produce year one, year two, year three, going forward? In other words, how do we measure? Because this isn't the end. I mean, clearly it's not the end. And to be successful in this step forward is going to make it a lot easier for whomever it is in this room to make a decision financially. So my question is, have you thought down the road, this is what we expect, this is the line that we will get to, and then be able to report back to us?
Madam Chair, that was a really great question, and probably something that we will want to talk at length about when we get to Senate Bill 23. Part of any project like this, and I know you have all heard of similar projects, whether it be in other states or in other large organizations where maybe they've run into difficulties. One of the most important things in a project like this, we're not just replacing the system to do the same thing. We need to set forth what our processes are today, how we want to improve those, and yes, be able to measure those and report back to the legislature, the governor, frankly, even the citizens of South Dakota. And that's a very, very important thing. The change management in a project like this is going to be beyond anything that certainly I've ever been involved in state government. So I think there's going to be a lot of people at the table, sir, that are going to be setting out what those objectives are going to be and then measuring whether we hit them or not.
You have a follow-up? Okay. Representative Kasson.
So we've talked about this. The 45 FTE being specialists kind of across the state governments coming to ramp up. Do we have any sense the effect that's going to have on those agencies for those people being, you know, gone for 2 years, 3 years, something like that?
That's one of the toughest, Representative Kasson, Madam Chair. That's one of the toughest problems that we're going to have to solve. And it's going to be tough on the agencies. And hopefully what they get back is newer staff that have come in, you know, sort of the next man up scenario, where we're going to have newer staff having to come in and work on things so that we can have more experienced staff to help us on a statewide level focus on their areas of expertise. And when we get done, kind of to Representative Mills' questions, some of those staff hopefully will want to stay on and help run the system from a central level as maybe part of whatever number of staff that we need to run that in an ongoing basis. And others will go back to their agencies as experts in the new system and the new processes. Because remember, I keep reminding myself and others that this is not just about software. This is about changing our practices, our business practices. We're running the same system for the last 35 years. 1988, it went live. And we've squeezed about every bit of functionality out of that system that we can. But we're still doing some of the processes the same way we did 35 years ago. So we have to focus on improving those processes.
Thank you. No, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay.
Thanks, Colin. Okay, that kind of, for the most part, wraps up. Bureau outlook, I want to just touch on a few things. I think I covered a lot of this, but just three things I wanted to hit on for the Bureau outlook. The phase out of federal stimulus spending, we're really looking at that over the next couple of budget cycles. We talked a lot about stimulus spending. There's the $100 million pool we want to look at. As this is phased down, to look at reducing that out of the budget over the next couple of years. Next one, recruiting and retaining staff. Talked a lot about doing that work, making sure that we're doing everything that we can to recruit and retain so that we're sustainable. You know, Keith Sanger from our financial reporting group, him and his team, we've really tried to look outside the box. We can't just sit here and post jobs and think that people are going to come and look at them. And so we've went to job fairs at Northern State, North Dakota State, UND, Augustana, USD, Black Hills State, across the board. We've really out there actively looking for those talented individuals in the accounting and finance field that have a heart for public service to really come and work for us, not only at the Bureau of Finance and Management, but also, I feel that we have a responsibility at BFM to make sure that our agencies are well staffed in the finance area. And then, lastly, we just got done talking about the ERP implementation. That's a
that's a really a huge, what I would describe as a once-in-a-lifetime project, and I look at it as an opportunity. I know it's going to be a lot of work, but I think there's a huge amount of opportunities to really create and foster a lot of change. Colin talked about all the processes that are 35 years old, really. So those are the things that we're looking at over the next 5 years to make sure that we continue to be the best financially run state in the nation. With that, Madam Chair, that concludes my comments. I'd be happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions for the commissioner? Seeing none, I want to thank you and your staff for leading BFM and for all the hours and contributions you do to serve the people of South Dakota. Thank you.
Thank you.
I did not announce this, but I will take, we have some time. Is there any public testimony here? Any public testimony? Okay, seeing none, we will then start our next hearing with the governor's office at 4 o'clock. We'll be at ease till they're here, unless they're here. He is. You are wonderful. I take it you signed in? All right, thank you. So we will begin with the governor's office budget, and good afternoon and welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon, members of the committee. My name is Travis Dovery. I'm the finance director for the Governor's Office of Economic Development. And in that capacity, I am also serve as the fiscal officer for the Office of the Governor. And I'm here this afternoon to present on the fiscal year 24 budget request for the Governor's Office. I do not have a slideshow to go along with this, so that when I get into the numbers, I will just reference the briefing document that was prepared by LRC. Brief overview of the governor's office. It is the lead office providing direction, leadership, and input to all executive branch agencies. As far as the fiscal year 24 request goes compared to the current year, there are no increases or decreases in spending, no major changes in how the office is structured, and no special appropriation requests. The workforce in the governor's office is made up of 22 full-time equivalents, and that includes 21 full-time permanent, 0.5 temporary seasonal, both those numbers within the governor's office proper, and then 0.5 permanent within the lieutenant governor's office. Typically have two summer interns, one in the fall and one in the spring. FTE utilization historically for FY21 was 20.99, and for 22 was 20.07. So the office remains pretty much nearly fully staffed, and the underutilization is just due to unplanned and untimed vacancies. We expect this to be full or near full in future years as well. Looking forward, LRC had asked for a five-year outlook, so it's maybe more appropriate just for a four-year outlook to the end of the current administration, and anticipate things to be stable. We don't anticipate there being any changes on how the governor's office is structured. One of the items I do mention every year as part of this is included as the memberships that the governor's office participates in. There are two of them, and then one in the lieutenant governor's office. The first is the National Governors Association. So this is a bipartisan organization that provides assistance to governors, governor's spouses, and their respective staff throughout the life cycle of a governor's term. This starts all the way from election day through their final year in office and includes idea sharing, best practices, and topics affecting all states. The annual dues for this membership is $37,900. Then we are also a member of the Western Governors Association, which is also a bipartisan organization that focuses on shared issues primarily affecting the Western states. And in this one, the annual dues are $39,600. We are also a member of the National Lieutenant Governors Association. Again, bipartisan organization, very similar to the NGA, but for lieutenant governors of the states. And the annual dues here are $1,000. I move into the numbers section of the budget request. So this would be on page 3 of your budget briefing document. The total operating budget for the governor's office is $2,675,176. This breaks down to $2,185,269 for salaries and benefits, which leaves $489,907 for operations. To further break down the operations, includes the major objects of travel, which includes travel to attend NGA and WGA events, as well as other in-state and occasional out-of-state travel. Contractual services is the largest line item in the budget, and this consists mainly of space billings paid to the Bureau of Administration, and then other centrally billed items such as BIT for service connectivity, and then other central services such as BHR, procurement management, and other such central services. And then general office supplies consists of stationary, postage, and general consumables. On page 6 of the briefing document is the Governor's Contingency Fund. So this provides for emergencies and unanticipated concerns of the Governor. This is used consistent with prior administrations and typically includes technology upgrades, membership dues, and again, unanticipated concerns of the Governor. Total budget in this fund is $75,000. And then on page 9 of the budget briefing document is the Lieutenant Governor's Office budget. You'll notice this is a very, very minor amount in the grand scheme of things. The operating expenses here is for Lieutenant Governor to attend NLGA events and some other in-state travel, and then also central services, phone, computer, space billing, et cetera. So not a lot to the budget for the Office of the Governor, pretty small and straightforward. That concludes my comments, and I would stand by for questions.
Thank you. Any questions?
Madam Chair.
Representative Derby.
Excuse me. Could you go over the permanent employees for the governor and the lieutenant governor again?
Madam Chair. Go ahead. Yes, Representative Derby. 21 full-time permanent in the governor's office, 0.5 part-time seasonal in the governor's office, and 0.5 in the lieutenant governor's office for a total of 22 FTE amongst the two budget units.
Any other questions? Senator Maher.
When you look at the salaries in the lieutenant governor, that must still be broken down a couple across different agencies because the payroll isn't necessarily matching.
Madam Chair. Thank you, Senator Maher. Yes, the salary budget for the Office of the Lieutenant Governor covers the Lieutenant Governor's time for the most part when he's presiding over the Senate. The remainder of the year, that salary is paid from the Governor's office and then whatever respective agency he may be working for on their behalf, currently as Ag Ambassador for DANR.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you so very much for coming. Appreciate it. And thank you for all you do with keeping that office where it needs to be.
All right. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone.
All right. Any public comment to this budget? Seeing none, we will move then. And we want to welcome the state treasurer. We also want to say thank you for accommodating to our schedule. We really appreciate it. And my co-chair and I will be having to attend another meeting, so we can listen to you online. So we'll. Again, so welcome, Secretary of Treasury.
Welcome once again. So whenever you're ready, please proceed to introduce yourself and any others, and we look forward to hearing your presentation. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, State Treasurer Josh Hader. To my right, I have Treasury Services Manager Melissa Hall, and she will sit with me while we do the Treasury Services Division report. And then behind me is Lee Deja Bay. She's our unclaimed property administrator. She will come up when we transition to that portion of the presentation. And also with me today, I have Deputy Treasurer Jason Williams, and we look forward to your questions throughout the presentation. Just real briefly on slide number two, which is up, I'll just run through our staff real quick. Again, Jason Williams serves as our Deputy Treasurer, and Melissa Hall is our Treasury Manager. Our Assistant Treasury Manager is Penny Almond. Tony Kenefick-Ashoff serves as our Finance Officer, and Nicole Stosh is our Cashier Manager on the Treasury Services side. On the unclaimed property side, again, Lee Deja Bay serves as our administrator and will join me shortly. Anissa Grambular is our compliance portfolio manager. Amy Allman serves as our claims manager. Jason Jarris is our risk manager, and we have a slide dedicated to that. And then we're pleased to welcome Kia Warren, who serves as our outreach manager, who started just this week. So we have, outside of me, 10 total staff between both divisions. And so what we'll do is we'll go ahead and move into our fiscal year 24 budget overview. And so our aggregate total budget for fiscal year 24 is just under $30 million. Now, when you break that down, our general fund request is just $633,753 of general fund dollars for Treasury Services and just over $29 million in informational dollars for unclaimed property. And I'm going to break both of those down in subsequent slides. And we go to the next slide. I think you just have to scroll up one. There you go. Yep, we still need that one. So on slide number four, the State Treasurer, just a brief outline of what we do. Through our Treasury Services Division, we serve as the receiver and safekeeper of all public funds paid into the Treasury. We also manage the state's banking relationship and all state fund transfers. Now, just to break down the budget, I just want to note one thing on the Treasury Services side. Our budget request is in line with the governor's recommendation, and it's important to note we are not asking for any new general fund dollars this year outside of the salary increases that were passed by the legislature last year for staff. So to break that down, that's $456, $422 in salary and benefits, $94.88 in travel, $161, $433 in contractual services, and the vast majority of that is our banking services contract with First Premier Bank, and we renewed that for 3 years last year. So I want to appreciate, thank you and appreciate your support for that last year. We had $5,710 in supplies and materials and $700 in capital outlay. And you can go down to the next slide. And so what we'll do is just take a little bit of a dive into the Treasury Services metrics on this slide. Total cash receipts that we processed last year was about $7.9 million. That's about a 25% increase from the previous year and about a 41% increase from 2012. Total funds our office disbursed back to agencies last year was about $7.1 million. And we sent the majority of those out via ACH, which was about $6 million. But what I want you to pay attention to on this slide is the very bottom left where it talks about checks deposited from state agencies. And the reason I want you to pay a little bit of attention to that is in our five-year goals on the last slide, one of the things that we talk about is the importance of reducing the number of checks we process every year in our office manually. So generally speaking, if you go back and look at our presentations, that's been over 500,000 a year. You'll notice last year we did about 421,000 checks. So we're starting to trend in the right direction. Of course, the natural question is why. Last year when we came to appropriations, as part of our banking services contract, we requested funds in that contract for remote deposit machines. And so what we do is we've sent those remote deposit machines out to those agencies that produce a large amount of checks. We actually have them scan those and then we get the digital copies. So we're trending in the right direction there. And why I am proud of that, why I mentioned that, is that mitigates the need for us to come before you and request additional FTEs by utilizing some of that technology. So with that, that's the Treasury Services side of things. Before I get into unclaimed property, does anybody have any questions on Treasury Services?
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Secretary, just curious, so we had a 25% increase from the fiscal prior year. Is it related to any of the funding that's coming from the federal government? I just was trying to kind of wrap my brain around that.
Sure.
Mr. Chair.
Yeah, please proceed.
Thank you. Melissa Hall, Treasury Services Manager, Treasury Manager for the Office of the State Treasurer. In short, yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
That makes sense. And but it was a 25% increase over the prior year. So had, and I'm trying to, I don't remember what we talked about last year, but I'm assuming that we had an increase from the prior year because of all that Fed money flowing through our system, correct? So you've seen a dramatic jump.
Mr. Chair. Representative Duba, that would be correct. It would be hard. I'd be hard-pressed to remember last year, too, as I age. Yeah. It's getting harder to remember things. But you'll hear me talk about this as the theme, is that's why, and this, we had a long discussion about this, now I do remember last year, where we did ask for some increased funding to utilize software to help us automate some of these processes. I'm going to touch on that a little bit at the end when we get into our five-year goals. Again, it's more cost-effective for us to utilize some of the software that's out there and leverage that than come here and ask for FTEs.
Understand.
So with that increase, what I'm trying to illustrate along with the increase is the fact that the software has been there, and I will provide specific examples of that as we move forward.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions right offhand?
Okay, with that, I would invite Lee DeJabert, Unclaimed Property Administrator, up, and we will go through the Division of Unclaimed Property, which is everybody's favorite. Okay, so we'll move on to the Division of Unclaimed Property. Again, just stop me as you have questions, but as you know, the Division of Unclaimed Property through the Treasurer's Office is holding millions of dollars that we're working hard to get back to rightful owners. Now, just a couple things right off the bat. Unclaimed property is an informational budget. That means we don't use any general fund dollars. And our expenditures for fiscal year 24 that you're seeing that I'm going to break down for you are in line with the governor's recommendation. We don't have any new dollars that we're planning on spending outside of the salary increases for employees that you all approved last year. So with that, I'll just break down the budget, and then we'll get into some of the metrics on the next slide. Just breaking down the budget, we have $495, $244 in salary and benefits, $29,701, $906 in operating expenses. Now, I would just point to your attention there that $29,701, $906 includes the majority of $26 million, the very bottom line, that's included in our projected returns, which we project for the next year. We have $21,200 in travel, $2.6 million is set aside for contractual services and audits. Just important to note, I talked to Lee right before we started. We're in hundreds of audits right now. You know, we can give updates on those, but that is what those projected dollars are for. $39,740 in supplies and materials, and I would just notate the majority of that is for postage that we utilize to send out for paid claims. And then, just as I mentioned, $26 million set aside for claims. But I want to transition, if I can, to the next slide, because this is going to break down some really important information for all of you. This is our advertising metrics. I want to be able to provide you with some very specific data to why we do what we do. But the first thing that I want to notate that I think it's very important is that we have a very small advertising budget in the Division of Unclaimed Property. It's $125,000 annually. That's it. We have never increased that dollar amount in my administration. That's been the same since the previous administration, and we've never went over that budget. We're very good at utilizing the dollars that we have and insourcing some of the things like radio advertising. We cut all the broadcasts in our office, so we do that. I do all of the ad buying for us. We don't outsource any of that. But I want to break down those metrics for you if I can. But before I do that, so our primary forms of advertising, just so you know what we're doing on a day-to-day, year-to-year basis, is social media, TV, live events. We are statutorily obligated to advertise in the newspaper one time per year. And then you'll see on there, I put radio. We don't do much radio at all. That's just when we have a live event, we'll usually go on and do, you know, $50 worth of ads just so individuals know we're coming to a specific community. So with that, let's get into the metrics a little bit. So when you look at social media, I would just notate we only utilize Facebook. We don't go anywhere else. We're not on TikTok, obviously. Maybe too soon for that, I don't know. But this past fiscal year, we interacted with more than 87,000 people on our Facebook page directly. And then just from a global perspective, our ad impressions on Facebook last year were about 265,000 individuals. And that generated about 14,000 clicks to the Unclaimed Property website. So we're seeing a very active participation on Facebook that continues to grow year over year. But the one I'm excited about, the one I want to talk to you the most about is TV. And that is the top right brown box that you'll see in the slideshow presentation. Now, Some of you are probably aware of our ads. Maybe you've seen them on TV, social media. Now, here's what I would tell you. Those ads are absolutely meant to grab attention, but they're also meant to build trust with the people of South Dakota that what we're doing by telling people to go to a website to see if they have money that's theirs, that we're not a scam. And that is really important to build that trust, and that there's proof in the numbers here. So let's dive into the metrics as it relates specifically to TV. So this past year, our website impressions from TV advertisements was about 57,000 people who went and visited our website, as best we can attribute from the dates that we advertised. We generated more than 4,500 claims from TV, and the dollar value of those claims is $16 million. Now, I want to point something out here, because as we go into the next slide, and you're going to see this with each one of our metrics, those claims were generated last year. Some of those claims were paid out last year, but we do have claims where people don't send in the information, or they're complex, meaning there's more than one person that may be apprised to the money. So some of those claims are paid out in fiscal year 23, and some have not been paid out yet because we don't have the required information. So when you look, you will see that that money is spread across two fiscal years, and I just want to notate that as you look at those numbers on the next slide. With that, the other thing that we do a fair amount of is live events. And that includes fairs, home shows, and other community events. We also go to like college parades, things of that nature. And the total attendance of all of those events was about 489,000 individuals. Now, that's not the number of people we reached, but I share that number with you to simply illustrate the large crowds that we have the capacity to get in front of for a very low cost in a very short amount of time. And again, the metrics on that. Last year, live events generated approximately 34,000 visits to the unclaimed property website. We were able to generate about 2,500 claims last year from live events that had a dollar value of $2.1 million. I'm going to say this each time. Again, some of those claims were paid out last year, some this year. Some were still waiting to pay out. Again, that is reliant on the complexity of a claim or if individuals have or have not given us the required information. And then finally, as I stated on the beginning of this slide, state statute does require that we advertise in the newspaper minimum one time a year. And you all can probably think of those when you pick up your paper. It's a long list of names by county, right? So to break that down, we did advertise in 74 newspapers last year. We reached about 168,000 individuals across those newspapers and a return value of about $1.1 million. So a decent impact. From that perspective, again, just pay attention to those claim numbers. Some were paid in fiscal year 22, some in fiscal year 23, reflected on the next slide. But I know I'm talking a little fast. I want to make sure you all get out of here on time. One final metric I want to share with you as it relates to advertising. So in 2019, we had a total of 12,000 claims that were paid out. Just in fiscal year 23 alone, and now this is filed claims, not paid claims. We pay attention to those later on in the year. We've had over 10,000 filed claims. And that shows me that people are paying attention to what we're doing, and we're very proud of that number. Now, we've been down in FTE for a while, and we're happy that Ms. Warren is with us, so that slowed our claim processing just a bit. But we're in the process of catching that up, and we always communicate that with those who have filed claims. So we'll transition. Any questions before I move forward?
Representative Van Huysen.
She can go. Go ahead.
Okay. Senator Foster.
Thank you. Can you give me an example of where this unclaimed property origin sources are? Like what, where?
Absolutely. Go ahead, Lee. I'll let you take that. Remember to
introduce. Mr. Chair. My name is Lee Desjabe, and I'm the unclaimed property administrator for the State Treasurer's Office. And our sources that we track are, first of all, of course, our state website. Anything, it defaults to state website. So if a person goes out there and files a claim, it has state website. And then it's up to the claimant at that point to change that. There's a drop down. We have various other things, friends and family. National website, that would be missingmoney.com, and newspaper, if they change it to newspaper, it logs that, public events, social media, and television. So those are the things that we track, but it's all based on if the claimant flips that.
Follow up. Representative Van Huysen.
Yeah, thank you. I have a few questions. And the first one may be dovetailing off of Senator Foster's question. Do you track in-state claims versus out-of-state claims? And do you track that over time?
Mr. Chair.
Proceed.
Yes, part of our year-end process is we look at what has happened in the past, and we do try to query up what is coming from in-state, basically a South Dakota address, versus out-of-state, and then also foreign. So we do analyze those every year to see where we're at. And during COVID, we concentrated mostly on South Dakota, and we had a great response. We reached a lot more South Dakotans by just concentrating on them instead of, we didn't have as much foreign because they couldn't get to us, you know, the lockdowns and everything. So it was very beneficial, COVID, as far as for our South Dakotans. We came up with new programs, new events, new things to do that we didn't have to do in person.
Mr. Chair, I'd be interested in, if you don't have it right now, if you want to report back, that'd be fine. But just sure. In-state, out-of-state, foreign, what that trend has been over 5 years, you know, whatever time period is convenient for you, I'd be interested to see that if you don't have it at hand. On your advertising, I have to say it seems like it's good to hear that the budget is the same as it's been. I certainly feel like I see the ads more than I used to, so I suppose I should compliment you on that. You're obviously doing something well. Can you talk, is all the advertising in-state?
Mr. Chair, proceed. Representative Van Huysen, yes, it's all in-state. We don't do any out-of-state advertising.
Okay, and then...
Now, Facebook, you know, when we do like the Sioux Falls area, that might may touch into Iowa,
right.
You know, Minnesota, but we do not target other states.
You don't target, right.
Correct.
Can you say a little more? I mean, your total spend hasn't changed, but it certainly seems to me anyway your strategy has. I mean, you went over TV, social media, and newspaper. Is that different than what was done prior to your tenure in terms of the mix of how you spend the money?
Good, proceed.
Yep. Thank you for the question, Representative Van Huysen. One thing that has been constant has been newspaper. That's generally in that $30,000 to $40,000 range every year. And I would tell you, looking at the buckets up here, we've probably shifted money a little more towards TV because we see better results from that than magazines. You know, older print type thing. So yeah, I would say that we've transitioned to a TV, and then we couple that with the live events. So those are the two buckets where I would say in my administration that we've focused more of the dollars than the previous administration, if that makes sense.
Yeah, just, yes, it does. Just one more. Can you talk through a little bit? My understanding is that the administration for unclaimed property, which includes the advertising, is continuously appropriated and not, can you just talk through how that works and what your approach is to it?
Mr. Chair.
Can I proceed?
Yes, we are a continuous appropriation in statute. We are obligated to pay claims, and we are obligated to pay our expenses, including salaries and benefits, from the unclaimed property fund. It has been that way since it was developed, and we continue that way. No general fund dollars are ever used. And our continuous appropriation right now in statute, at the beginning of the year and the end of the year, our one fund in the accounting system is $50,000. And we try to keep it around that. It's relatively low at this point, and that is where we're paying the claims out. It is very low considering that we do millions and millions of claims, but we do a transfer at least once a month to the general fund to move that money out from unclaimed property. However, if we spend more money than we have taken in, which is a good portion of the year on claims and expenses, then we have to pull money from the general fund to bring our fund back to 50,000. We are mandated to be no less than 50,000. So October, November is when we get the bulk of our funds. We send lots of money, millions and millions of dollars to the general fund. But like right now, we're not receiving funds. So now we'll be pulling money back from the general fund to cover our expenses and claims. That answer your question?
Mr. Chair, if I, Representative Van Huysen, typically it takes us 24 to 48 hours to get responses back, so we will do that with the trends. We'll send that to staff, who always do a great job of sending it to all of you. If you have any questions on that further, obviously you can go through this process. All of you, and I'm not done with my presentation, but I would just invite all of you to stop down and talk anytime. We're happy to have you in.
Representative Duba.
Mr. Chair, Mr. Secretary, I know that there are rules that are, they're probably federal rules that govern banking and what you can and can't send, but when you talk about foreign nationals not being able to make the trip here, is it a certain dollar amount that you are not able to ACH? In other words, do I have to meet a certain, that's what I'm looking for, is what is the criteria that says, okay, we did a quick look at this claim, boom, out goes the ACH, versus this is this dollar amount or this dollar amount, and this is what you need to do to prove who you are. Do you understand what I'm asking?
Mr. Chair.
Please proceed.
At this time, unclaimed property does not ACH for claims. We actually mail a paper check. It is partly due to our banking. We have large dollar amounts that would go overseas, and our current bank will not allow us to wire money because it's not traceable once it leaves New York. So we go through Bank of New York Mellon, and it's not that we're not able to, it's just that the tracking of it is very difficult, and we have a hard time with foreign individuals as it is. A lot of fraud attempts are on foreign.
Sure.
And so it's just a better process for us to send a check. We will send that check however they want, FedEx, UPS, however they wish us to, but we will only send a check.
Follow up. But if I'm a South Dakotan and I have a $134 unclaimed property claim, are you going to send me a check or are you going to ACH me?
Mr. Chair.
Proceed.
We're going to send a check mostly because that's how the accounting system is set up at this time.
Follow up. So what do you think my next question is going to be?
I'm going to let you ask it.
Will you move to an ACH type system to save yourselves time and money?
Mr. Chair.
Proceed.
Our current system, our database system, has that ability to do ACH. It's just a matter of our accounting system at this time and how things interface.
Mr. Chair, I listened to the last presentation. If you update the accounting system, that might make it easier for us, but I'm not putting in a plug for BFM on that. So,
any other Representative Kroll?
Secretary, I have a question. I'm a new guy on the block, so you probably all know
Welcome.
The answer to it. But how can, in accounting, I'm looking at unclaimed freight or unclaimed property, how can that be classified as revenue if we have the ability, or we might have to pay it back? Wouldn't it go on the liability side?
Mr. Chair, it does. Thank you for that. That's a very good question for a new guy. I like that. So here's how we've kind of looked at it. Yes, it's carried as a liability, right, on the balance sheet. So let's say, and I'm going to get into this on the next slide, and let me just go into this so you can kind of have an understanding of it as you're looking at the next slide, just for rough numbers. So let's say, you know, this fiscal year we've brought in about $98 million. That's under unclaimed property receipts on the bottom left. And we've got another $2 to $3 million more that'll come in. So just for fun numbers, let's say it's $100 million this year, Representative. What we tell you we think we have the ability to return is about $26 million a year on average. Now, it's even tough for us to hit that from time to time. And the reason is, and we'll get into this into another slide, is because foreign claims take quite a long time. But let's say we hit that number. Let's say we return $26 million. That's still $74 million that you all get to use from a budgeting perspective, however you so choose. What we're saying is the amount that comes in for receipts every year is significantly higher than what we have the capability to return. That, I don't know if that really gives you a good answer, but that's how we look at that process, but it is carried as a liability.
Follow up.
But even though there is a difference, no matter how, you know, wide it is, that money at one point in time could be claimed.
Mr. Chair, yes, it can be claimed. It could, so just for awareness, unclaimed property could be claimed in perpetuity. There's no cutoff. It doesn't say, like, after 3 years, if we don't find somebody, too bad. It's claimable forever. So that can happen, that it's claimable in perpetuity per state statute.
Any follow-up? Representative Van Huysen.
Just kind of following up on Representative Kroll's question. Do you keep track of how old the claims are? Like, we have X million dollars that are 5 years old, X million that are 10 million. Is that something that you're capable of producing?
Mr. Chair.
You proceed.
Representative Van Huysen, yes. Would you like me to just kind of send you a breakdown to the committee so all of you can see that?
Yeah, I just think going back on his question, it might be interesting to say, well, this amount of money has been there for 40 years, you know, whatever. Kind of give a concept of that.
Yeah.
If that's something you're able to do.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chair, Representative Van Huysen, absolutely. Happy to send that out.
Thank you.
For all of your review.
Probably a question along those lines would be, what is the length of time that the unclaimed property has been received to when a request goes out? Is there an average, or is there complete variability?
Mr. Chair, let me phone a friend.
Mr. Chair, as you can see, that we might bring in $100 million and we'll return 26 if we're on a really, really high year. The likelihood of a property being claimed is significantly downgraded after 5 years. We used to have a five-year dormancy period, and we found that at 5 years, it was more difficult to locate people, even within our state. We switched it to 3 years, and we have much better success because people have not moved as much. However, after 5 years, the CAFR group does a liability for their report on our dollars, and they calculate that out. And we come down to, after 5 years, it is significantly less likely.
Okay, thank you. I thought I saw a question. Senator Meyer.
Yeah, so this is going into some of those calculations. So what I was told one time is that when those banks, like take Wells Fargo, move their banking charter here, and they do these massive stock trades around the world, and we're dealing with fractionated cents and stock trades, some of that money comes back to unclaimed property, and we will never, ever find the owners of that money. Is that a true statement?
Mr. Chair? Yes. In the past, we have allowed aggregate reporting for anything under $50. We are down to anything under $10 at this point. And most states are trending towards nothing in aggregation. So because of computers, you have the data, you know who it was and everything else. You have their information. We should receive that information so that those pennies and fractional cents and everything else can be claimed. Right now, if you have something, say, from 10 years ago that was under $50, say dividends, and they reported it as aggregate, you would have to contact the company that sent us the money, and they would have to tell us where that money was reported into us as aggregate. We have no idea of how, so we have to work with the company to get your money back. It's a very lengthy process. But if you are over the $50 and we have your name and address, we're totally dependent upon what the company sends us. If they send us your name, your address, your date of birth, your social security number, bingo, we're good. But if we get a name and a city, we get something like, you know, Steve Johnson in Canton. He may have moved on to Sioux Falls. And we have no idea what Steve Johnson that is until they start a claim process and we start asking for documentation.
Other questions? Okay, please proceed.
Well, and Senator Meyer, for year number five, I like the shape of that question. We will go, inside joke, we'll tell you all about that sometime. Again, one thing I want to reiterate on slide number eight, this is just the bottom right. This is FY23 receipts July through December. Again, we've brought in about $98 million this year. We do expect another $2 to $3 million to come in. So when you look at that $26 million return estimate we put out there, that's still $74 million all of you get to work with and determine how that plays a role in the budgeting process. So, you know, I just want you to think about that and think about the role unclaimed property plays in helping with the overall budgeting process.
One more follow-up to that.
Yes, sir.
In years past, there was the recommendation that we didn't want to exceed the $40 million. Can you tell us where did that come from, what the expectation is, and how we should continue to budget based on that?
Mr. Chair, I will hesitate to give you advice on how to budget. You've got a smart group of people here. What he's referencing is $40 million. I believe anything that comes in from unclaimed property over that is considered just you use that as a one-time expenditure. It's not an ongoing expense. And so what I would tell you is when you look at this $98 million, last year was $85. We have, as an office, we have no say-so on what banks send us from a given year. We can't call and say you need to send us more. And so without giving you a direct answer, what I would tell you is that this number can fluctuate. So if I come here next year and say it's $22 million and that's it, you know, I would let you know that when you're thinking about if you should be utilizing that money as ongoing or one time, I hope that answers that question because it can really fluctuate. And that's where that initial $40 million came in is I believe folks said, hey, if there's anything over that, we've got to treat it as one time because the next year it could be way up, it could be way down. While we do our best and we work very closely with the Bureau of Finance and Management and with Mr. Melhoff to give you numbers, there's no exact science to it. When holders report numbers, that's what we're getting. So, again, without advising you how to do that, I hope that gives you some sort of sense of my thoughts on what you should do with these large amounts like this from year to year.
Thank you.
Okay.
Question, Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just following up on that, so you used the $22 million figure, and I'm just curious, have we been below $40 million in the last 10 years?
Mr. Chair, one moment. Lee's got her binder with. It'll take just 1 second.
And then while they're doing that, just a follow-up. If not, what's the lowest it's been in that time frame?
Please proceed.
Representative Mills, what year was that?
2013,
and what was the total? Our net receipts were about $31 million. So it has been below that, and I would say that's probably the lowest in my recollection. Go ahead.
Mr. Chair?
She'll follow up. Okay, you please proceed.
The reason that is so much lower, FY13 and earlier, is because Wells Fargo had acquired Wachovia Bank in FY15. And so we saw a huge increase due to that merger.
So then may I revise my question then? So from 2015 on, what's the lowest that we've seen?
Mr. Chair.
Proceed.
Our net receipts were 52,000 in 2015.
52 million.
I'm sorry. our actual total receipts were 69 million, but in FY14 is when we saw the bulk of the Wachovia money come in, and we were at 124 million. And we've increased every year since that, except for 2020 and 2019 during COVID. We were down to 70 million and 74 million, but our net receipts were 47 and 48 because we had a lot of implementation of how to handle people during COVID, how to handle claims and everything else. We had a little bit more expense.
Representative Mills, any follow-up?
Probably could keep down this rabbit hole for a while, but I think I'll be okay.
Representative Van Huysen.
Just a little farther down that rabbit hole. there was a year in there, maybe it was 2015, when we changed the remittance period from 5 years to 3 years. And so there was a year where we got 3 years worth of money in 1 year. And that might be that 124 million year. And it was a big spike. I think that's right.
Mr. Chair, Representative Van Huysen, that is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Boland.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And just kind of maybe to summarize just a little bit here, all of this is dependent, this whole process we've been talking about here, it's all dependent on the fact that these charters are in South Dakota, and if a bank or a financial institution decided to move them, this whole process would wither away and go away. Is that accurate?
Mr. Chair.
Proceed.
Senator, that is accurate.
Okay. Just want to think everybody needs to know that. So, all right. Very good. Thank you.
Senator Ware.
Nobody's heard me talk yet today, so I might as well say something. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Are we recruiting more banks to come to South Dakota? Is that one of the missions of your office?
Proceed.
Mr. Chair. Senator, it is one of our missions. We started on that as an office, working with the Bureau of Finance and Management, Governor's Office, South Dakota Bankers Association, and some other folks that were around when some of these charters came here. The answer is yes. We put together, with my deputy Jason Williams leading that, a very good team. Here, the challenge we've had is, with COVID, none of these banks wanted to meet. So now we're getting back, and they've changed leadership. To get to the point where you can have those conversations, take some time. So what I would tell you is, we are working on that, but it's a long play. It is not something where Bank X is gonna move next year. There's many layers, many discussions, and ultimately, love my role as state treasurer, the governor will play an important role in that part of the process as well, in that end goal recruiting, right? So she has that a part of her process to grow South Dakota. And so hopefully we can do that with some of these charters. We're not there yet, but it is a long goal play for us, absolutely.
Thank you, Senator Ware. Any other questions before we proceed? Okay.
Thank you for those questions. What we'll do is we'll move on to slide number 9, and this is all about risk mitigation in unclaimed property. Just want to share some numbers with you that I think you'll find important. Our team had 350 fraudulent claims that were internally rejected from our team last year. I want to build on top of that. If you go down to the next line, our software program, which is called CAPS, K-A-P-S, rejected an additional 374 claims. Now, go to the dollar amount to the right side of that. We rejected over $24 million in fraudulent claims last year. To me, that's an incredible number for a staff of 5, along with our software. I just want to publicly tell you how proud I am of my team and that group of people. There is more stress than what meets the eye in the Division of Unclaimed Property because of the risks we face from fraud, and the fraudsters know, especially foreign claimants, that tampering with and changing documents is something that's very easy for them. So, you know, you'll also see this in our 5-year goals on the last slide, that we continue to work on in-house training and the utilization of software to ensure that we're getting it right 100% of the time, because rest assured, the bad guys are out there trying to get this. Now, on that note, on these slides, you'll see where it says foreign risk factors. That's fairly long. I'm not going to read through that. But if you want to read through that, that just talks a little bit about some of the additional risks that we're seeing as it relates to fraud. Any questions on fraud before I move into slide 10? Okay, seeing none. On slide 10, per this committee's request, we have included some 5-year goals for both Treasury Services on claimed property. I'm just going to share 2 of those with you very briefly. On the Treasury Services side, you've heard me talk about this a little bit, Representative Dubai started with this with your first question. We continue to leverage technology to help us ease manual processes as our workload increases. Let me give you one really short example. And we brought this up last year as part of our increase in funding. We've partnered with a company called Alteryx. And what the tool we use from them is an account categorization tool, and it saves our team about 1.5 hours a day. And what it does is it helps us take away the manual categorization of every single transaction that goes through the state budget. And it does those automatically. Now, that took a ton of work, hours and hours and hours at the front end. But now when they come in every day, they can do a quick review. They don't have to manually do that. And the reason I bring that as I said earlier, that helps us mitigate against needing FTEs in the future at this time. So we're very proud that if we can spend an extra $2,000 a year, I believe it's $5,000 is what you approved last year. For $5,000, we can mitigate the need for two FTEs on the Treasury Services side. We can maintain that group of four, and as our workload increases, stay on top of it. And then on that, so, and I just said this on the last slide, with regard to unclaimed property, $24 million last year we protected against. I mean, over 600 fraudulent claims. We have a goal of continuing to train our team and leverage technology to the best of our capability to protect against some of those threats. With that, Mr. Chair, I do want to sincerely thank you all for your questions today. I know we have a little bit of follow-up to do. We generally get that done within 24 to 48 hours. Again, I want to thank all of you for serving on this committee. This is the one that has early mornings and late nights, and you still find time to get it all done. So thank you very much, and God bless. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Any further questions before they adjourn today? Okay, thanks again. We have some new pages that didn't get introduced earlier, so if you'd please come up to the center as well, introduce yourself, tell us where you're at, your age, and what your future plans are.
Hello, my name is Tess Vonisch-Feldkamp. I attend Jefferson High School, and I'm in the 11th grade. After graduation, I plan to attend Georgetown University.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Musso. I'm from Lyman High School. I'm a senior, and I plan after high school in May, I plan on attending University of Nebraska-Lincoln.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any public testimony today, this afternoon? Okay, seeing no public testimony, as a reminder, staff briefing begins at 7:45 tomorrow on the docket. Let's see here, what do we have? Tribal Relations, Veterans Affairs, and the Military. Any questions or comments from the group?
Mr. Chair.
Representative Van Huysen.
I would just mention, too, we're adjusting our schedule a little bit from what you have because we have House Caucus at 11:30 tomorrow. So the presentations tomorrow reach about 15 minutes shorter than what's on the handout. But we'll just go from one to the next. So
thank you for that information. Any other business to conduct today? If not, Senator Wick.
Chair, I move we adjourn.
All those in favor of adjourning signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you. You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you.